Hello everyone, good afternoon. Today I'll be talking to you guys about immunogenicity concerns with chimeric antigen receptor T cells or CAR T cells. So FDA regulates a wide variety of gene therapy products. So these products range from plasmid vectors to things like bacterial vectors, viral vectors, and more complicated gene therapy products such as genome edited cells or genetically modified cells. And these products are being developed to treat a wide variety of indications ranging from human genetic diseases to cancer, infectious diseases, and the list keeps on growing. This is a very exciting time to be in the field of gene therapy, as the number of the types of products and the number of indications that these products are developed for is growing, and it's very exciting. So right now we have few approved gene therapy products in the US. So we have two viral vector-based gene therapy products, Luxturna, which is based on AAV2, and Zolgensma, which is based on AAV9. So these are viral vectors that are used for in vivo gene transfer. And we have five cell-based gene therapy products, namely Kymriah, Yescarta, Tecartus, and Breyanzi. These are anti-CD19 targeting CAR T cells, and Abecma. These are anti-BCMA targeting CAR T cells indicated for relapsed refractory multiple myeloma. So we have had recent successes in gene therapy, but we all are aware of challenges we've seen in the past in this field. So as we think about taking this gene therapy globally, just wanted to make a point that this is a long road ahead. And there are many challenges that are still unknown in this field. And as we move forward, we need to take proper precautions with regard to, assessing safety and efficacy of these products. So why do these gene therapy products require special considerations? Well, so these are novel products. They're often manufactured using complicated technologies. For most of these products, in vivo mechanism of action is not always well understood. And the risk associated with these products is not completely known. And part of that is because the model systems that we use to study these products have all limitations. And because of these limitations, these risks associated with these products cannot be easily assessed. Because of these reasons, gene therapy products requires special considerations. So today we're going to talk about cell-based gene therapy or specifically a chimeric antigen receptor expressing T cells, or known as CAR T cells. So when we talk about CAR T cells, although CAR T cells have shown promise, and then we now have five approved CAR T cell products in the US, there are several concerns and challenges that still remain. Just to highlight a few of them, inflammatory toxicities such as cytokine release syndromes or neurotoxicity associated with this therapy is still of concern. Specificity, both the on-target off-tumor specificity and off-target specificity, is always a concern with this type of engineered cell product. We've seen resistance and relapses with these products. So again, next generation of CAR T cells will have to deal with these challenges on resistance and relapses. And lastly, the focus of today's talk will be on immunogenicity, because these are chimeric molecules that are expressed in the human T cells. There's always a concern regarding immunogenicity against the transgenes that is used. And now, In adding to that complexity is that these CAR T cells are being modified using various genome editing tools. So some of these genome editing components that gets used during manufacturing can elicit immune response. So there's a concern with regard to immunogenicity concerns of these genome editing components that is used in manufacturing. So in this short presentation, we will focus on just one aspect of CAR T cells, which is immune response against CAR T cells, and we'll try to answer these two questions. Does it occur, and does it really matter? And we'll go over three case studies to try to answer these questions. So the first case study looks at the humoral and the cellular immune response in CAR T cell therapy. So this is a CAR T cell therapy where the CAR T cells were made to treat renal cell carcinoma. The CAR T cells targeted an antigen called CAIX, C-A-I-X. The single chain variable fragment of these CAR T cells were derived from a murine antibody, and 11 patients were treated, and the results were published in 2011. So what was observed in this study was that anti-CAR antibodies were detected in almost all patients with increasing titers, which remained detectable throughout the evaluation period. Anti-CAR T cell response was also detected in 7 out of 9 patients. And interestingly, 2 patients showed T cell response against retroviral vector backbone that was used in manufacturing. And in almost all patients, CAR T cells did not persist for a long time, and they only persisted less than 2 months. So one of the conclusions we can make from this paper or this study is that both the humoral and the cellular immune response can be detected during CAR T cell therapy. And perhaps, although it's not clear from these studies, this humoral and cellular immune response against CAR T cells may play a role in CAR T cell persistence and efficacy. The second case study we will quickly look at has to do with the immune response against Cas9, which was used during manufacturing of a genome-edited TCR T-cell therapy. So the product in this case is an autologous anti-NY-ESO TCR transduced T-cells. The CRISPR-Cas9 system was used to remove endogenous T-cell receptor and PD-1 receptor. Residual Cas9 levels were measured at the end of production, and they were below the limit of detection. And in total, 3 patients were treated, and the data was published last year in Science. So what was observed in this study is that anti-Cas9 antibodies and anti-Cas9 T cells were detected in all patients at baseline. Levels of Cas9 antibodies did not increase after gene therapy, which was a good news. Modified T cells in this case persisted for up to 9 months, and immunogenicity concerns of Cas9 can be mitigated by process optimization. So the highlight of the study, in addition to other conclusions, was that the concerns, at least the immunogenicity concerns related to use of Cas9, can be mitigated by process optimization and removing these Cas9 from the drug product. And the last case study that we'll look at deals with the humoral immune response and during CAR T cell therapy. So the CAR T cells in this study was anti-TAC-72 CAR T cells, and the single chain variable fragment used in this CAR was derived from a human antibody clone CC49. So basically, these are CAR T cells that are targeting TAC-72 expressed by cancer cells. One of the ways response was measured in this assay, in this trial, was that soluble 70 STAC72, which is released by the cancer cells, is detected by a ligand binding assay, and a change in a STAC72 levels, serum levels, would indicate a positive response, and along with a tumor progression was measured in this case. So what was observed? So for the ligand binding assay, it used a CC49 antibody. So this is the same antibody that that the CAR expresses. And what was found was, during the assessment of PD marker, there a large drop in serum soluble TAC72 was observed by this ligand binding assay. However, no efficacy was observed. So there was no effect on tumors. And then the CAR T cells did not last for a long time. And they all, I think it lasted for up to 14 weeks. So what then happened was that once the further analysis revealed that there was a anti-CAR antibodies in the serum of these patients, and the anti-CAR antibody interacted with the CC49 antibodies that was used in the ligand binding assay, and because of the presence of these anti-CAR antibodies, the ligand binding assay was giving a false negative results. So what was the impact of a humoral immune response in this case? Well, so as I said, the anti-CAR antibody or anti-CC49 antibody that was developed in these patients resulted into a false negative result in a PD assay. There was a rapid clearance of CAR T cells, and there was a lack of efficacy. It's not clear at this point whether or not the rapid clearance of the CAR T cells and the lack of efficacy was directly attributed to anti-CAR humoral response. But something to keep in mind when we run these serum-based assays, that these presence of these interfering antibodies or anti-CAR antibodies can impact the assay results. So what about immunogenicity of FDA-approved CAR T-cell products? So we can look at Kymriah as an example. So this is a immunogenicity statement from a product insert. And what you can see is that for Kymriah, when a pre-existing anti-CAR antibodies or anti-mouse antibodies was detected in about 86% in one study and 91.4% in a second study. 5% of patients in a Juliet study, which is a second study, had a treatment-induced anti-CAR antibodies. And the conclusion that was made, at least based on a limited data set, was that there was no evidence that the presence of pre-existing or a treatment-induced antibodies had any impact on safety and efficacy of CAR T cells. The same story is true for Yescarta. I'm not gonna go over and read this, but I just wanted to show you that if you look at the immunogenicity statement for Tecartus, Breyanzi, and Abecma, it's a similar story, which is summarized in this table. So for all five approved CAR T-cell products, humoral immune response was detected in a subset of patients. And when the safety and efficacy was analyzed, it was either unclear or was not found. So what it means is that there's no evidence that the immunogenicity or the humoral immune response against CAR had affected safety and efficacy of these products. One limitation with the data is that this is a small sample size, and then in almost all cases, T cell response was not measured. Just to summarize, whether or not that immune response against CAR T cells occurs, The answer is yes. Based on the clinical case studies that I just showed you and the published data from approved products, it clearly occurs. The question about does it matter? Well, I mean, the data obtained so far has been very promising, but as you all know, CAR T cells are increasingly getting complex in design and manufacturing process. So it's not clear whether or not this will pan out to be true for future products. The other difference between the approved products and some of the future products is that approved products are all autologous, and the immunogenicity concerns with allogeneic products are not clear at this point. So I'll just end with few perspectives for future. CAR T cell field is still very young, and the risk associated with this product is not fully understood. Again, CAR T cell immunogenicity and its impact on safety and efficacy is not completely known. As you all know, each product type is unique, so the risk may vary from product to product. And one way to handle this would be to have a risk assessment that is product specific. And as we increase our understanding of the product and the manufacturing process, this may also help identify product attributes to predict immunogenicity and reduce process-related risk. And the model-informed drug development can be an effective tool to understand immunogenicity risk and develop mitigation strategies for future. So with that, I'll stop here and leave you with my contact information. Thank you very much for your attention.